So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dennis, K7BV from Yaesu.
Hello, I'm not Gordon. Hi there. There we go.
And there we go.
That last speaker must have been tall.
There you go.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dennis Motschenbacher. I'm K7BV. At this time, I happen to be the Executive Vice President for Yaesu for North America. And as you can tell, I'm a little bit nervous. This is an opportunity that I didn't think would come my way because I had cancer a little while back, and I wasn't sure that that was going to turn out okay. It did, but I wasn't sure I was going to be able to get back to work. And I fortunately am back at work, and one of the first things I found out when I came back to work was that Yaesu was finally going to get in the digital game. And I was really excited about that. As a matter of fact, I did a little thinking about retirement, but I thought, man, I don't want to miss this. This is going to be too much fun. We finally put our system completely together. We are calling it System Fusion. And I worked directly for the owner of the company, and I spoke to him about what I thought to be the perfect place to introduce this system, and it had to be here. That had to be here. You people in this room, people like me, I'm a plug-and-play kind of ham radio operator, and I have been for 50 years. I enjoy the things that are imagined, and with the technical expertise that's in this room, you people bring things that the rest of us just think about. You make them into fruition, and you bring them into the hobby. Sometimes the manufacturers pick them up and they run. And sometimes these things go far, far further than amateur radio. But it's people like you that do that. And for that, we are all very grateful. I'm not technically astute. Larry Wolfgang is sitting here from the ARRL. Larry used to have to show me how to turn my computer on without hurting myself. So he's well aware that I am not the sharpest fella as far as digital technology. But I do have the honor of working for Yaesu and introducing our digital system. We feel this system will lead amateur radio and provide you with some opportunities to take what we've dreamed up so far. I'm certain, I don't know if the boss is certain, but I'm certain that you guys will take this system and do things with it that we hadn't even dreamed about doing. System fusion is exactly that. You know, we all know what fusion means. It means bring things together. And our approach to digital communications was to recognize that there was a place still for analog FM in voice communications. And there certainly is room for digital. And the two of them, we felt, could be put together. And we could provide a system where everybody could get along and people with interest in both sides could, let's say, enjoy the hobby together. We knew we had to bring some products out. The first thing we brought out was our FT1 DR handheld, which is like a souped-up VX8R, which was a very good handheld that we came up with. But it has digital capabilities as well as analog. It's a dual-band radio, and it's available in both silver and black. And then recently we introduced, and you may have seen it in the demonstration room, a really good-looking new dual-band radio, also analog and also digital. And also we've finally gotten to the point where we've got touchscreen capabilities on this thing as well. Like down at the bottom there, you see some menus of this particular screen, and they are touchscreen. You can advance further into the menu through that point. What we're going to introduce today for the first time is the thing that brings it all together, and that is our repeater. It's called the DR1. It is analog and digital. Both modes can communicate through this repeater. And shortly, not necessarily today, but very shortly, we'll be also introducing a product into the system, which we call Wires X, which will allow this system to be put on the internet as well. So I get so excited I start stuttering. I'm so excited about the fact that the owner wanted to recognize and not leave out all the people that have spent thousands and thousands of dollars over the years purchasing analog equipment. We did not want to introduce a system that all of a sudden cut them out. Buy our digital, you're out of the game. That's not what our intention was. We wanted to bring something revolutionary into the market, and we hope that when you're done today and when you pick up some of these brochures and have an opportunity to study this system, you'll agree with us on that. We wanted to have a system where you, the user, can decide what is the best system to use at a given moment when you're communicating with somebody. Is it better to switch back to analog because you're getting to the very edge of digital communication distance capabilities where you could still communicate with FM? Maybe that would be a choice that you might want to make. Or maybe there's some digital information that you would want to transfer and you were speaking using the analog mode. We wanted to give you those choices, and the best way to do it, we thought, was with the system that we came up with. So we selected, much to the debate of all of amateur radio, we selected C4 FM, the FDMA, for FDMA FM communications. As you can imagine, and there's probably many in this room who have their own personal likes for D-Star, Moto Turbo, and on and on and on. A lot of these people were not happy. We understand that, but it was important to the owner of Yaesu to bring forward a digital mode that he felt would provide maybe as good or better digital communications that was better communications than what was being offered today, and something that would be around for a while. We had the opportunity of having a joint venture relationship with Motorola, which of course gave us, who did not have or had almost no digital experience, it certainly gave us a chance to look inside their labs and inside their engineers to learn a lot. And we did learn a lot during our 4.5 years. But one of the things we did discover, helped us make our decision, was that C4 FM was a very important mode, and it was a very standard mode for professional communications for FDMA. And because of that, there was a lot of existing products there, and through our study, we found that was going to be around a long time. Part of the cancer was my saliva glands didn't make it, excuse me. Small price to pay to be alive, you know? So that was our decision to go that way. Now, the C4 FM system that we're introducing comes in a multitude of modes, 4 of them specifically, and certainly if you notice down at the bottom of that list is analog FM. So our radios will do these 3 different modes that you see there, plus analog FM. We've got a voice and a data, where you're talking, but there's beneath that, you could be sending, as example, your position or other data. There's a full bandwidth, by the way. Our digital mode uses 12.5. We'll discuss that in just a moment here, too. 12.5 kilohertz instead of a narrower bandwidth. You could have the full 12.5 kilohertz used for voice, or you could, for a high-speed data transfer, you could use the full 12.5 for digital, and of course, then again, back to the analog FM mode. Now, I'm sure at this time your minds are pretty starting to say, well, how do you do this all on the same frequency and all that? We're gonna get there. We like to think that we've developed a system that's FM friendly, meaning everybody can get along here. And to do that, we had to develop software and technology that we call automatic mode selection. And if you study these two images that are here, you can see what we mean by automatic mode selection. The radio will, unless it's told to do otherwise, it will automatically select the mode that it needs to communicate with the person who is, as an example, recently transmitted to you. It will automatically determine whether that's a digital signal, another Yaesu radio using C4 FM, or if it's analog FM. you look over on the right image, you'll see that the repeater does the same thing, or can be set up to do the same thing. Our DR1 repeater actually has a number of different modes that the control operator can put it in, but one of them is, to let this intercommunication go back and forth between various users, recognizing that some people may want to have a digital handheld capability, some people don't, or some people aren't ready, or some people's wife isn't ready to let go of the money yet for a new transceiver. So, what we want to have is a situation where the amateur radio operator can decide. Now, we took advantage of the fact that we're introducing some new radios to introduce a few new features because of the capabilities that we have. And one is our group monitor function. If you look at it, you can see. Now, this is a direct path or direct communications where with the transceiver set up in that mode, one can determine people who have been registered into the group, where they are, how far away they are, and what direction they are. When one starts thinking about emergency applications for this, emergency response, I'm sure your mind, can spin a lot of reasons where this might be very, very much advantageous to keep track of all the different responders that are involved. We have a snapshot function that sounds like maybe a toy. With the optional microphone, you can take a snapshot and pass it to another Yaesu radio, another Yaesu radio with digital mode. It's not just a toy. It also can be an extremely valuable tool for, let your imagination run. But certainly in emergency situations, a first responder going into an area after a tornado, whatever, can send pictures back to a control point. As we all know, pictures sometimes speak 1,000 words. So it does have a use. We have our smart navigation, which again is involved with recognition of distance and orientation of yourself and other users. The backtrack function, that's another feature that's in here. This comes in handy where you can set your point where you're at today, at this moment, and then venture off someplace, and you can always get back to where you started with this. Again, maybe sounds like a cool camping or hiking feature, but maybe more important, maybe a life-saving feature if we're sending amateur radio operators out into disaster areas and they need to get back out of there. This always tells them, keeps them familiar with where home is at. So there's our repeater. We are familiar that some of the other digital systems that have been out there that the repeater setup has been, at least we've heard that it's been difficult for some individuals to set up. We've tried to make this one a very easy setup. The intent was to be plug and play. In other words, if you have your group has a repeater today, the intent of this repeater is to be able to remove that, put this one in, immediately all of the analog users that have been on that repeater are back on the air, and those who slowly but surely come to the game and decide to pick up one of the digital devices, they can still join the rest of them. Nobody's forced off the air, nobody's forced into digital. Friendly, again, friendly system. Just a couple of features about it. A lot of this group is very familiar with these frequencies, band spreads. Our output on this device is from 10 watts up to 50 watts. Our studies, we did a study using the repeater guide, as a matter of fact, to try and find out what kind of powers did we need to make available to people. And of course, everybody wants that repeater to be on the air. They don't want to see it cycling off due to heat and all that. So we did take extra time to make sure we had plenty of heat sink and a large enough cooling fan to keep this thing going. And last but not least, this repeater can be connected right up to a battery or UPS and be able to switch right over in the event of local power failure for all the obvious reasons. Some other features already, we already mentioned the automatic mode selection. This is a huge capability, and I'm not gonna take all of your time today to discuss that, but while we're in here, Jerry, my cohort, in the demo room is setting up a DR1. It's not gonna be functional, but he's also putting out the literature about this new system. And so from that, you'll be able to get going, at least learning about this system. Again, this is just a pictorial image showing you how this system will work. Just a couple of small, nice features that we heard from people that they like to have a speaker in that thing. You would think that would be like a no-brainer, but apparently it's not, particularly when people are trying to put one together using radios and all that. Sometimes things get a little tough. We built the speaker in so that the person setting the thing up can hear what's going on the repeater. Some people may actually decide to use this thing as a base station. It may be their base station, and the repeater can be hooked up with a microphone as well. Our intention is for this to be very flexible to work with. So our products, we started introducing them very slow, easing our way into this thing to make sure that we did it right. The FT1DR has been around now about a year and a half, 2 years, something like that. And the FTM400 was introduced at Dayton, and yesterday the first radios were shipped to the North American dealers. So if you've got one on back order, keep an eye on your dealer because they're on the way to the dealers right now. The DR1 repeater will be here no later than November, and then the system will be complete. The Wires X, or the internet connection capability, I'm not sure of the timing on that. It could be even just at the same time, but I haven't got that information yet from Japan. So System Fusion is here. You know, we should go ahead and speak to the elephant in the room. No offense, Scott. Was that Scott? I didn't mean that. But D-Star, it is not compatible with D-Star. You know, that's a big question that we hear a lot. And and of course, the answer there is it is not. You know, I'll give you my personal feelings for what they're worth. And hopefully nobody's recording it. So, but I do have a personal opinion. And my personal opinion is there's a place for D-Star. There's a ton of them out there. They've found some really nice niches with D-Star. The emergency communication community has adopted it widely in some areas. But there's, you know, from the data I gathered, there's like 7,000 repeaters in the United States, and I believe there's 700 of them that are D-Star. There's room here for a number of opportunities, and we want to be there. We'd like to lead the. We'd like to think again that you people will help us take this system into the future, and of course, the first question that's going to come up is pricing and availability and all that. We're very. It's not the first question. Okay, but. Let me say, the question we hear frequently is when will this stuff be available, and do we recognize that not every group wants to buy a new repeater? The answer is yes and yes. And it will be here soon, and we do know that we need to use some creative marketing efforts. I didn't want to get into a long session of answering questions here. I'm happy to take one. Because I recognized you already, but you people deserve a break, and I understand there's already a format for if you wish to go into the demo room where our stuff will be at. We'll be there and answer all the questions we can. Yes, sir.
I think the first question before pricing is the technical specifications for the C4FM digital mode available so that we can build our own radio hardware, homebrew radio hardware, and write our own software to run on those radios and the computers connected to them so that we can interoperate fully with your radios?
And I'm frankly really glad you asked that question. One of the because I'm not a technical individual, I immediately hit the owner was the one that told me about the system, and I hit him with a bunch of what I thought to be, you know, pretty normal questions for a gray-haired guy, you know, it's been doing this for 50 years and still thinks tubes are cool. And, you know, one of my questions was, will a Kenwood radio operate on this system? Yes, an FM Kenwood radio will operate through this repeater. I said, what if Kenwood or ICOM decides they want to develop a C4 FM radio? Will it be able to be used on this system? His answer was yes. So his intention was not to develop a system that was strictly Yaesu proprietary. Now, I know what I'm saying, but I don't know how to technically answer that question. Your question, of course, is perfect. You can't go develop homebrew applications without us making more information available. And it's my understanding, my interpretation of what he said, that we are going to make that available. Is it available today? Immediately, no. You know, I just got this. And I don't even have the manual yet, you know. And actually, you're right, I wouldn't have read it anyway. But
I would very much appreciate any effort you could put into getting a more complete answer to that.
I understand that.
In the coming months or whatever.
Yes.
That would be great, thanks.
I think my job, while I prefer to play in the HF DXing radio side of our house, I do represent all the products, and I think he's made it pretty clear to me that my life has changed, and that I can get back on the air on HF sometime in the future, but for the next year or so, my job is to make this system as widely known as possible, and to feed back as much information as I can to him.
Dennis, did you want to take more questions?
Well, it's
up to you.
Well, I'm fine, but these people have been in this room all day, and
you guys want them to answer some questions?
Yes.
Yeah. There you go.
Okay, so we don't want to answer any questions. Thank you very much. Yes, sir. There was a gentleman. Somebody's got the mic. Yes, sir.
My name's Jerry Escalante, N7YGE. I really have a want for digital and would like to see someday a manufacturer that would put a insert either wireless or a connector on the radio in order to attach a keyboard. Using a mic is very cumbersome, and I just wonder why manufacturers do not consider the opportunity to be able to put a keyboard on a radio such as the one that
yes.
just came out by Yaesu.
Yes. Your question is one that's very similar to one I put to the owner about could I hook my computer up to this? And the answer was yes, but what I could do is do firmware upgrades, you know, with these radios. But I said, could I transfer data from my computer other than that? And the answer I got back, as I understood it, was no. And I said, well, that's too bad. Because I agree with you, and I will struggle to get that. I believe that, I mean, if you're going to call it digital, let's be digital. You know, and I'd like to see us go there. And I don't think these radios, as they're sitting today, can do that, though. Yes, sir.
You had a slide that I could not quite make out with showing the splits of the modes. It looked to me like there was you could do digital voice, data, and interleave the two, and I couldn't quite see the speed.
Let's see here.
Yeah, now what are the colored tabs down there? I can't quite make them out.
I'm sorry about that. Maybe I should try it. And thank you for this input because I'll have to do this a lot more times, I'm sure. Down there, it's talking about digital voice, digital air correction.
Oh, that's just the over the air.
And then below that is 6.5, 6.5. So in that particular mode, the voice data mode, half of the bandwidth is devoted to voice and the other half is devoted to data. In the next mode, the voice full rate mode, it's all digital voice. All 12.5 is devoted to it. And in the other mode, the data full rate mode, excuse me, the full 12.5 is devoted to digital.
Okay, follow-up question. What in the high-speed data communication mode, the data FR mode, what is the data rate? How fast do we push the bits?
Yes. Jerry, are you here?
He says 9.6.
I think it was 9.6, yes.
Well, okay.
And I'm very sorry. I should have been able to answer that right off the top of my head, but I believe it's 9,600.
And I...
Practice. I better not be.
I'll offer a comment.
Yes, sir.
I was here at the DCC when ICOM introduced the ID1. They got a wave of feedback then, which was universally ignored by ICOM. I mean, these guys are the collected wisdom of amateur radio data. And they ignored it because they were radio guys. These were networking guys. They were... you know, they understood networking, and ICOM didn't, and they have suffered because of that. I urge you not to make the same mistake.
I missed the point, though. I missed, what is it that was ignored? Oh, I do. Oh, believe me. I don't know how to say to you, except, you know, I've been in this game 55 years, and it's really fun to get a paycheck to be in the game as well, but... My hands are shaking, not from nervous, but I'm just so excited to be here and to be with this group, knowing that from this day forward, now the entire amateur radio community will know what we're doing and can communicate with me that things that I can take back to Japan. So, yes, sir, I agree with you. Microphone, yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Bruce Perrins, K6BP.
Yes, sir.
Whole list of things. Sorry if this goes by fast. First of all, please do send a technical person when you can, because you have a whole room full, and you know we'd be a lot happier talking with one. Can you tell us if this uses the AMBI codec?
I cannot.
Yeah, okay, our belief so far is that it does.
And that's my belief as well, and I didn't want to confirm it because I'm not absolutely sure.
Okay, the next question is, I notice this is 12.5 kilohertz. It's... time division, it's twice the width of D-star. Isn't the normal mode that one person is talking and the other slot is empty?
In other words, you can
use all 12 kilohertz for voice. So you can be twice as wide as D-star. You can have... the normal mode for a repeater, which is one person is speaking at a time, in which the other time slot is either someone using data, maybe, or it's empty. So when that time slot is empty, you're using twice the channel and still doing the same thing as D-star, aren't you?
I think, from my understanding, the reason we went to 12.5 had more to do with that in the digital mode, we could move more data and faster data.
Okay, and finally, I won't give you too hard a time today. If you're talking digitally on the repeater, don't all the FM stations hear nothing?
No, if they're the AMS mode will recognize that you're talking digitally, using digital communications, let's say, to the repeater, and it will interpret that if the control operator has set the repeater to be this way, it will then retransmit in analog.
It'll retransmit FM. What if the control operator has set it to transmit digital transmissions as digital?
If it has it to set digital...
I think the answer here really is that this isn't really making FM and digital compatible, is it? It's just gatewaying digital to FM, and everyone's on FM.
I guess your opinion is valued, but it's our belief that this system is something that's been wanted very, very much in the amateur community.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. Mr. Alaska, I believe it is. Yes,
Greg Eubank, KL7 Echo Victor. What I'm curious with is what's the bit rate of the C4 FM? Is it compatible with the K9NG, RG, ARTH? The 9600, the existing 9600 bit per second modem that we currently have.
I don't think so, but
it's 4 FSK. Okay, it's 4 FSK, so it's not compatible. I'm sorry to hear that.
One more, then I think we'll break, gentlemen.
Bruce, I think when they first announced this, they are not doing TDMA, so that empty slot is not even even
it's
in the game.
It's all one channel?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's twice as wide as D-Star for digital.
Yeah, they can reduce to 6.25, but they're not doing the two slot from the original announcement. I also noticed that the analog FM, it appears that you're only doing the 25 kilohertz, what we now consider wide, which we used to consider narrow.
Yeah.
And I didn't see 12 and a half kilohertz.
No, I didn't either. And I kind of, as I was learning the system here within the very recent past, I was kind of looking for that too. But at this point, this is what I've been told is what we've got.
Well, thank you, Dennis. Thank you so much.
Okay. I just want to say again, thank you for letting us do this here. You know, I'm sure that, like this gentleman said, if we had a speaker who was much more digitally inclined available, I'd have brought him here. But I just didn't have anybody here today. So thank you for your patience.
Yeah.